Well, welcome everybody. Gone very quiet all of a sudden.
That's probably good since we're here in the church. And I thought, look, we might just begin by a moment of prayer, because we are in the church building, of course, and we know that we have the Lord with us present in the Blessed Sacrament. So I thought we might just take a moment to acknowledge that we are in His presence and He is here in our presence, with us and amongst us. So I just invite you all to pause for a moment, maybe turn your eyes towards the tabernacle, to the Blessed Sacrament, and we acknowledge the presence of the Lord amongst us. He promised to be with those who gathered in His name, and we wouldn't be here this afternoon if we weren't intending to gather in His name. So let's just be still and quiet for a moment and acknowledge His presence and ask Him to be with us with the gift of His Spirit. Jesus, we acknowledge you present amongst us in the Blessed Sacrament. Through your gift of yourself, through the gift of your body and blood, you enter into a deep communion with us and invite us to listen to your voice, to take your word into our hearts, to find it within ourselves to respond to you with courage, and then to go out proclaiming your love and your presence and your truth to the world. We ask you to be with us this afternoon, to open our minds and our hearts to all that you might want to say to us through the course of the afternoon. We thank you for calling us together, and we renew our faith in you and our commitment to you. And we turn now to your mother and ask her to support us with her prayers. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Just checking my new Fitbit to see what time it is. 2:51.
I've got about half an hour to share a few thoughts with you, and then, as you've just heard, there's going to be the opportunity for some questions. I've got a great long talk prepared, and I'm more or less going to follow it, but I asked Father Al to put this here so I could move around a little bit rather than being stuck all the time behind the lectern. And hopefully what I've got to say might challenge you, might confirm some of the things that you've always believed, might lead you to ask a few questions, to think a little bit more deeply about some of these important issues that I want to share with you this afternoon. I've just come from lunch at the cathedral, and the acting dean there, Father Don Kettle, said to me, when I saw the topic of your talk, he said, I had to have a second look. He said, I thought that it must have been some sort of joke. Well, it's not a joke. The talk that I've prepared for this afternoon is one that I think is a really important one for us, and I hope that I can invite you to a slightly deeper, perhaps more than slightly, reflection on the church, because that's really what I wanted to talk to you about this afternoon. So the topic that we chose, or that I chose, is love the church, you must be joking. And I wanted to explain at the start why I've given it that particular title. Because it's not immediately obvious to everybody, in fact it may not be very obvious at all to many people, that the church is an institution or a reality that we're supposed to love. So I want to suggest to you this afternoon that the church, I was going to say our church, but every time I want to say our church, I find something within me saying to me, no, no, say the Lord's church. Because before it's our church, it's His church. That this church, which is of course the community of the disciples of Jesus, is something that we're invited not just to know about, be a part of, but actually to love. Let me explain where I'm coming from in opening up the topic in this way. Some years ago, I was getting ready to celebrate Midnight Mass on Christmas Eve. Because Midnight Mass is at midnight, it's amazing how often the cathedral gets phone calls on Christmas Eve saying, what time is Midnight Mass? Well, it's at midnight. But because it's at midnight, you've got to do something to keep yourself awake, because normally I'm well and truly asleep by the time midnight comes around. So I decided I'd have a look at carols by candlelight on TV. One of the artists this particular year introduced, she sang a number of songs, and she introduced her selection of carols, all with a very religious message, as you would expect most Christmas carols to have. She introduced her selection with the remark that at Christmas we celebrate the birth of Christ, who came to bring us peace. We'd all agree with that, I presume. But she went on to say, so we gather to celebrate the birth of Christ, who came to bring us peace, not religion. That's an interesting notion, isn't it? That Jesus came to bring us peace, and somehow or other, this is what she's hinting at, we turned it into a religion which isn't what he wanted at all. Sometime before that, in the course of a talk I was giving, this was before I was a bishop, to a group of Christians from various denominations, I said something which just seemed obvious to me, and I thought would have been obvious to everybody else who was there. I drew a link between our faith in Jesus, the celebration of the Eucharist, which most Christian traditions celebrate in one way or another, and the church. So Jesus, the Eucharist, and the church. And I suggested that these three things actually went together and belonged to each other. As I said, I thought that would have been a very obvious, very standard kind of thing to say. But when it came time for question time, someone put up and really got stuck into me because I dared to suggest that the church was a privileged way of encountering Jesus. And then that person walked out. So you can see what I'm doing. I'm building up a little scenario here of different ways of thinking about this particular topic that I wanted to talk to you about this afternoon. On another occasion, I remember reading an article in one of the weekend papers a couple of years ago now about a very famous Australian tennis player, I won't tell you who it is, but you might be able to work it out, who was being interviewed not just about his tennis, but about his life. And he said that even though he was brought up Catholic and his family still practiced their religion, he didn't anymore because he thought being Buddhist was better than being Catholic. Because after all, he said, Buddhism is a spiritual religion. As if to say that there's nothing spiritual about being a Catholic and belonging to the Catholic Church. That seemed to me a strange thing to say, and I did think that this guy obviously knew a lot about tennis, didn't know much about the Catholic faith, I thought at the time, and I probably still think that. On yet another occasion, I was driving home one night, and I heard a discussion on the radio about whether or not you could be a good person without believing in God. The whole thrust of the discussion, and I'm sure many of you have heard this kind of idea before, the whole thrust of the discussion seemed to be that going to church certainly didn't make you a better person, and that in fact some of the very best people you'll ever meet never go near a church. And the implication behind that was the idea that religion and church really weren't all that important and didn't have a big part to play in whether or not a person lived a good life or not. And then to cap it all off, I recently came across a book with the title, Love Jesus, Hate the Church. I can give you lots more examples about this kind of idea, but that's where the topic for this afternoon's talk came from. Because it's not just a catchy title, it actually expresses something that a lot of people have come to believe. Love the church, You must be joking. This afternoon, what I really want to do is to talk with you and to perhaps invite you on a little bit of a journey with me to try and understand why I certainly don't accept that proposition, and that I think that Jesus and church belong so closely together that if you were to pull them apart or try to separate them, you'd actually be undermining them. Now, maybe you all agree with me on that, and so all I'm doing is preaching to the converted, but it may be that you've got lots of friends who wouldn't see it this way, and maybe as we think about this and pray about this and talk about this, it might help you when you come to have discussions at uni or at work or at school or wherever it might be. One of the reasons, of course, why people sometimes suggest that of course we love Jesus. Jesus was a wonderful person. He left us a wonderful example, fantastic teachings, all of those sort of things. But the church has really messed it up over the centuries. One of the reasons why people think that way, particularly at this time in our history, is because of the terrible scandal of sexual abuse. And the fact that, I don't want to say so many, there are so many clergy and religious and lay people, for that matter, in the Catholic Church who have done these terrible things. And there have been a lot of leaders, bishops and others, who haven't handled it very well. And so you can kind of understand why people might look at the church and think, well, why would you love this institution which has harmed these people and covered up for these people? What kind of an institution is that? Why would you even bother with an institution like that? I'll develop this a little bit more as we go along, but I think one of the challenges there is the idea that as soon as you call the church an institution, you've summed the church. But of course, there's a bit more to the church than simply the idea of the church as an institution with structures and authority, people and all of that sort of thing. But you can understand why people might be very disillusioned, let's say, with the church. Not just our church, but all Christian churches. But apart from that, I think there are many other reasons why some people want to walk away from the church or turn their backs on the church. I won't list them all here. You'd be as well aware of them as I am. Maybe they reflect something of your own ill at ease about being ill at ease about the church. But let me just point to a couple. For some people, it might be the teachings of the church, which they find particularly hard. I'm not sure that we're living in a period in the church's life where the doctrinal teachings of the church cause quite as much turmoil as they used to. It's hard to believe that in the first 3 or 4 centuries of the church, there'd be riots in the streets in all the major cities when somebody came up with a particular understanding, say, of the person of Jesus and whether he was divine or human or somehow or other both. And other people would be arguing with them. And while we might think, oh, that's a rather esoteric sort of, you know, up in the air kind of discussion, sometimes these people would end up fighting in the streets over this. So I think those days are probably gone, at least in countries like ours. But when it comes to some of the moral teachings of the church, it might be a different story. Other people walk away from the church because they say, well, you go to Mass on Sundays, it's just so boring, it's uninspiring, I don't get anything out of it, so why would I bother? And then there are other people who say one of the things that I mentioned before, look, I know lots of people who go to church on Sundays, who go to Mass on Sundays, they're no better than they should be. I know what really goes on in their lives. So what's the point of going to church? It doesn't make it better. In fact, sometimes it seems to make you worse. This idea that there are lots of things about the church that are challenging, even disappointing, sometimes even more than disappointing, really distressing, it's nothing new. It's good to remember that there were many things about the message of Jesus which during his own lifetime were very hard for people to cope with. He wouldn't have ended up on the cross if that wasn't the case. We read the Gospels and we see people flocking after him because of the miracles he worked, the beauty of the teaching that he was giving, his own example, his own magnetic personality, all those kinds of things. But it didn't take much for a lot of them to turn against him. And there are some quite specific examples. I won't go into them all now, but those of you who know your Gospels well will know that in St. John's Gospel, when Jesus starts talking about the gift of the Eucharist and the gift of himself as food for us, and telling people that unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you won't have life in you. Doesn't quite put it this way in the Gospels, but the message is people thought, this guy's crazy. But the Gospels do tell us that they found this too hard to believe, so they walked away. So there's nothing new about the fact that Jesus himself and the church which we believe he founded has been a challenge for people. In the light of all of that, I wanted to put two questions to you this afternoon and to invite you to think about how you might answer them. And the first question is, who is Jesus? Some people express that question like this: who is Jesus for you? I don't think that's a great question, because that's inviting you almost to create a Jesus of your own. I don't think we should be asking ourselves, who is Jesus for me? But rather, who is Jesus? And we'll talk a little bit, or I'll talk a little bit more in a moment about how we might begin to answer that question. The second question, I think, is, what is the church? We could say, who is the church? That would lead us into a particular direction. At the moment, I'd say, stick with the question, what is the church? And again, not what is the church for me? That's an important question. But the real question is, what is the church? Another way of saying that is, why do we have a church? Why did God give us the church? So again, it's not, what can I get out of the church? What will give me a real lift and a sense of, you know, thrill about belonging to the church? But what is the church in God's mind? So who is Jesus and what is the church? As regards to the first question, who is Jesus? You realise, of course, that it's not my question at all. It's Jesus' own question. You'll all be very familiar, I hope, with the stories in Matthew's Gospel and in other Gospels as well, of the time that Jesus had his disciples gathered around him, and he says to them, who do people say that I am? From a human point of view, it's almost as if Jesus is trying to get from his disciples some sense of whether he's being successful in getting his message across to people. Do they get it? Do they understand? Do they really realise what I'm saying? So he asks the disciples, and they tell him exactly what people are saying. Well, some say you're Moses come back to life, some say you're Elijah, some say you're one of the prophets. And in a sense, they're not bad responses, because what they're doing is indicating that all the people have understood, if nothing else, that this man Jesus is a man of God and a man sent by God. But all they can do is think about Jesus in terms of what they already know. Jewish people, of course, have great respect for the prophetic tradition. So they think of Jesus and he's like one of these famous prophets they read about in their scriptures. They think, well, he must be one of them come back to life. So they're not completely wrong in the sense they've got a bit of a sense of how important Jesus is, but they're very far from being completely right, because that doesn't exhaust the importance of Jesus at all, at least as far as we are concerned. Jesus then turns to the disciples, remember these guys who are the closest followers of his, the people he spends his days and nights with, the people that he probably sits around the campfire with when all of the crowds have gone home. And he says to them, well, what about you? Who do you say I am? And notice he doesn't say, what about you? Who am I for you? He doesn't say that. He says, who do you say that I am? Peter speaks up, he's the leader, of course, so he jumps in and he gives the answer. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus congratulates him. Because while all the other people kind of had a bit of an understanding and really hadn't quite got it, Peter has got it. He's absolutely right. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. I won't go into the fact that the story then goes on and Peter messes it all up, because Jesus starts to tell them what being the Christ, the Son of the living God, means. That he's going to have to go up to Jerusalem, and he's going to be handed over to the Romans, and he's going to be mocked, and he's going to be scourged, and he's going to be crucified, and then on the third day rise again. And Peter's listening to all of this, and he thinks, that can't be right. That's impossible. How can the Christ, the Son of the living God, end up like that? So Peter starts saying to Jesus, forget it. No way. Peter wasn't interested in a Messiah who was going to have to suffer. And I'll just drop this in. Some of you have heard me say this before, but I'll just drop this in for you to take away and think about. Peter, when he said you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, was 100% right. And yet he was completely wrong. He was right in saying Jesus was the Messiah, but he was wanting a Messiah according to Peter's idea, not according to Jesus' idea. So having the words right is important, and it's a great start, but it's not necessarily the full picture. And that's why I keep saying the question is, who is Jesus? Not who do I want him to be, who would I like him to be, who have I created him to be in my own mind, but who is he really? Those people who got Jesus wrong right at the start have had people doing the same thing ever since. I don't know if any of you ever read the book or saw the movie of the Da Vinci Code. When I was a bit younger, this was the big scandal. Dan Brown wrote this book about Jesus and about him, Mary Magdalene, were lovers, and that Jesus didn't really die on the cross, and that after he recovered from that terrible experience, they had often got married, and now their descendants were scattered all around the world, apparently. We would think this is a crazy thing. But it gives you an example of how people can get Jesus completely wrong. That makes a great film or a great novel, but nothing to do with the truth, obviously. All of this is leading me to say something that I think is important that I've hinted at already. These days, lots of people would be prepared to acknowledge that they admire Jesus, they think his teachings are fantastic, they're very impressed by his courage and his fidelity and all of these things, but that he was just another great religious figure, a bit like Muhammad, or the Buddha, or Confucius, or one of these sort of people. And that their followers made a mistake by turning the teachings of this great person and some of these other great people into a religion. I have a very good friend who is a Jewish rabbi. We're very close friends, and we talk about these sort of things sometimes. And he says to me that he thinks that if he had been alive in the time of Jesus, he would have followed Jesus. Because he sees Jesus as the best example of the beauty of the Jewish faith. But this friend of mine, his belief, and it's a belief that would be common in many Jewish circles, is that it was St. Paul who messed it all up by turning Jesus into a god. So we just get this all the time. There are so many people who love Jesus and admire Jesus and want to follow his teachings, but they don't see him the way our Catholic faith sees him. That leads me to the point that I wanted to throw, not a point I want to throw out to, but a question I want to suggest that you really think about. One of the things that you might reflect on later today or tomorrow or whenever you have time, is the very question that Jesus put to those first disciples. What about you? Who do you say I am? Jesus is saying that to each one of us here this afternoon. If we want to find out who Jesus really was, then the best place to go, at least at the start, is the Scriptures, and particularly the Gospels. And so if you're serious about asking the question, there's really only one way forward, and that is to get more and more familiar with the Gospels. Because they're the most developed witness to the fact that Jesus lived and to what Jesus was all about. But let me remind you of this, and this is where the link between Jesus and the church comes into play. I don't know, some of you will have done scripture studies when you were at school, others will have done reading about it and been interested in it, but you just have to stop and think about it for a minute. Jesus gathered this group of disciples around him. They were passionately committed to him. They gave him everything. They invested their whole lives in following him. And then he was executed. That must have meant for most of them a deep experience of disillusionment. You can imagine them on that Friday night, or particularly the next day, the Saturday, after the death of Jesus, saying to themselves, "We had thought that he was the one. We believed that he was the one who had come to show us the truth about God. But now, he's been arrested, he's been tortured, he's been murdered, and his body is lying in the tomb. So we must have been wrong." And then, completely without any real expectation on their part, they experienced Jesus as alive again after his resurrection. So, everything gets turned upside down for them. They go from passionate commitment to Jesus to deep despair, probably, and then to another experience of passionate commitment, but so much deeper. Because with the resurrection, what God is really saying is everything that Jesus said and did is true. So these disciples, their whole life now is on fire with this. They start preaching, and particularly after the ascension and Jesus returns to his Father in heaven, they start preaching, they move around, they're telling the stories, and of course they would gather together and tell the stories to each other. Do you remember that story Jesus told about that father who had two sons, and one of them wandered off and the other one stayed home? Or they might say, "Remember when Jesus was in the temple forecourt and the scribes and Pharisees brought that poor woman in who'd been caught committing adultery, and they were all ready to stone her to death, and all Jesus would say to her was, 'I don't condemn you. Go now and don't sin anymore.'" They would keep telling these sort of stories, remembering these stories, sharing them with each other, encouraging each other to be strong in their faith, and eventually, as they started to get a bit older and realised they weren't going to be around forever, they thought, "We'd better start writing these things down so that the people who come after us have got something to base their faith on. And we can do it because we were the ones who were there. If we don't do it, who knows what crazy stories are going to come up with." So gradually, they started collecting these stories in written form, and then over a long period, four Gospels, as we know them today, the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, emerge. What does all that mean? It means that the community of the disciples of Jesus existed before the Gospels existed in written form. In other words, the church came first, and out of the church came the Scriptures. Not the other way around, but the church came first. The people who were disciples of Jesus, who committed their lives to him, who gathered together to support each other in the faith, that came first, and out of that come the Scriptures. So the Scriptures themselves, the very place where we learn who Jesus is and what Jesus was all about, are actually actually the work of the church. We wouldn't have the scriptures if we didn't first have the church. So you can see already this really intimate connection between Jesus and the church.
I'm only up to page 6. I've got another 6 to go. I haven't got time for the other 6. I'm going to have to shorten this a little bit.
But I think I've tried to make that really important point. Even from the beginning, Jesus and the community of his disciples, today we call that the church, were intimately connected with each other. And it was the church that kept alive the memory of Jesus, the truth about Jesus. That's not a bad description of the role of the church, of the role that we all share in. The church keeps alive the memory of Jesus, the truth about Jesus. And if you follow that through to its logical conclusion, if we lose the church, we will eventually lose Jesus. If the church, if I can put it this way, if the church goes under, ultimately Jesus goes under with the church. That in itself is reason enough to love the church. Not to love everything about what some of the people in the church have done in the past and might still be doing today and into the future, but to love the church, this group of people who across 2,000 years have kept the memory of Jesus alive and the truth about Jesus alive. I'm going to jump ahead because I think I want to make another really important point before we begin to bring this to a close and open it up for questions. If you do read the Gospels carefully and you try and delve into them and understand what they're actually saying, one of the things that's going to become very obvious to you is that very early on in the ministry of Jesus, he takes a vital step. He starts to call people around him. The four Gospels, particularly the first three, begin with stories, or some begin with the story of his birth, of course, and those things, but in terms of his public ministry, they begin with Jesus calling people and saying, come and follow me. He gathers a group of disciples, a big group of disciples. And then at a certain stage, the Gospels tell us that he calls them together, and out of the disciples, he chooses 12. And then we see, as we follow through the Gospels, that out of this 12, he chooses 3 who are closest to him. And out of those 3, he chooses 1 who is the leader of the whole show, and that's Peter, of course. What Jesus is doing right from the start is creating the church. Christianity, the Christianity that truly follows Jesus, isn't about individual people thinking, I'm keen on this Jesus, I think I'll guide, let my life be guided by his teachings. The true follower of Jesus recognizes that it is part of Jesus' desire that people form a community together, a community of disciples, which has a structure. And that structure includes that first group of 12 apostles, and then within that group of 12 apostles, ultimately, the one who is the leader. In our Catholic tradition, we would see the bishops, some of them might be pretty ordinary sort of people, but we would see the bishops as the inheritors of the role of the 12 apostles. We call the bishops in our Catholic Church, we call the bishops the successors to the apostles. And within that group of bishops, within that group of successors of the apostles, we call the one who ultimately leads them all, the Holy Father, the Pope. We're being faithful to the structures that Jesus himself put in place. But when you read the Gospels carefully, you look at the way Jesus works so closely with this group of disciples, you realise that he hasn't just called them together, but he's forming them. He's shaping them into the kind of community that he wants them to be. And ever since that time, the church, this community of the disciples of Jesus, has been called to look back and evaluate itself in terms of its fidelity to what the Lord wanted his disciples to be. So what are some of the things that Jesus insists on? The one that jumps out at me more than any other, and is very relevant for some of the questions that I began with this afternoon, is that Jesus over and over again keeps telling his disciples, you've got to be a community of forgiveness. Now, he wouldn't have said that if he didn't know that the community and the members of the community were going to need forgiveness, because if anything was certain, it was that they were going to fail from time to time, they were going to mess things up from time to time, sometimes in small ways, sometimes in big ways, and that they wouldn't be able to hold together as the community he needed them to be unless they were a community that was marked by forgiveness. So one day, Peter says to Jesus, how often must I forgive my brother or sister if they hurt me? Seven times? And Peter thinking, this is overwhelming. Seven times. The number seven, of course, in the Jewish tradition has a sort of a special meaning, and it means sort of extraordinary amount. So Peter thinks he's being a really big-hearted guy and says to Jesus, how many times must we forgive? As many as seven? And Jesus says, no, not seven. 70 times seven. What Jesus is saying is, in the community of my disciples, there is always forgiveness offered and received. Not just from the Lord, but amongst each other. And you'll find if you then look into St. Paul's letters, he'll be saying things like when he writes to a Christian community, bear with one another. Put up with one another. Forgive each other as soon as a quarrel begins. So one of the things that Jesus says about his church, his community of disciples, that it's got to be a community of forgiveness. There are many other things that Jesus says, and I can't go into all of them this afternoon, but what I will want to finish with is this. Let's go back to the top. Love the church, you must be joking. I would say, if you love Jesus, then you will love the church, because that's what he wants. And when we love someone, we try to do what they want. Jesus created the church. The church isn't the creation of the first apostles. It's not the creation of St. Paul, as my Jewish friend thinks. The church was created by Jesus. It is his way of being present in our world today. We might think he could have chosen a better way. Certainly if we look at the first 12 apostles, we might think, had I been around at that time, I wouldn't have chosen any of them. They're all a hopeless bunch. But Jesus leads the way. Jesus shows us the way. He invites us to think a little bit deeply about these things. Why would he have chosen 12 men, 11 of whom completely let him down when he needed them most? Was he stupid? He didn't know what he was doing? They fooled him and managed to convince him that they were better than they were? Of course not. So why did Jesus do that? And why does Jesus continue to do that? What is that telling us about the church? What is it telling us about Jesus and the way he works? And if we come to an understanding of what it's telling us about Jesus and the way he works, it's actually telling us about God and the way God works. Because Jesus, as Pope Francis keeps telling us, is the face of the Father's mercy among us. Jesus knows that it can be difficult to say yes to the church and love the church. He knows that there will be things about the teachings of the church, particularly the moral teachings of the church, but not only those, which are really hard for us, really difficult for us to deal with. So much so that we'd like to find someone who can tell us that the church has been wrong for the last 2,000 years and now there's a whole new way of following Jesus. He knows that some of us might find it hard to drag ourselves to Mass on a Sunday morning if we've been out late the night before, unless you happen to have an evening Mass on a Sunday like this parish does, that makes it a bit easier. But he knows that that can be hard. He knows that we'll find some of the teachings difficult. He knows that it's easier to stay in bed sometimes than to get up. Remember, he experienced it himself in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was in such agony as he thought about what lay ahead of him, needed his friends. Jesus was human like us in everything but sin, remember. Needed his friends to support him and encourage him, and they were all asleep. Jesus knows, he understands how hard it is, but he is still asking us to say yes to the church, because in the end, saying yes to the church is the best way to say yes to Jesus. Loving the church is the best way to love Jesus. So our yes to the church is in fact a yes to Christ. I'm going to finish with just a few words, not from Pope Francis this time, but from Pope Benedict. They're words that he spoke during the World Youth Day in Sydney 10 years ago. I was there, most of you would have been there. I don't remember him saying these words, but I'm sure that he did because I've seen it written down in lots of places. I think they're words that can really help us as we bring this part of the afternoon to a close. Dear friends, says Pope Benedict, life is not governed by chance. Life is not random. Your very existence has been willed by God, blessed and given a purpose. Life is not just a succession of events or experiences, helpful though many of them are. Life is a search for the true, for the good, and for the beautiful. It is to this end that we make our choices. It is for this that we exercise our freedom. It is in this, in truth, in goodness, and in beauty, that we find our happiness and joy. Do not be fooled by those who see you as just another consumer in a market of undifferentiated possibilities, where choice itself becomes the good. Novelty usurps beauty, and subjective experience displaces truth. Christ offers more. Indeed, Christ offers everything. Only he who is the truth can be the way, and therefore also the life. Thus, the way which the apostles brought to the ends of the earth is life in Christ. And this is the life of the church.